Smarka K. Smarka K. Smarka K. Andrew. Winja Warham. Jesus. Nomen mene Chendru. Isila Chwechmi. And those are two languages that you probably never heard before, unless you played a video game called Far Cry Primal. Those were two languages that I myself helped to invent. And who here has played Far Cry Primal? Also known as Far Crimal, I just learned. All right, so you've heard these things, yeah? And if you've played the game before, you know that these languages are spoken by the tribes within the game. The main tribe of the game, the tribe of the player character named Taka, is the Wenja, or if you're Wenja, you actually say Winja. Wenja is also spoken by the Uta, which was originally a Neanderthal tribe, but they changed that to just this bunch of kind of inbred cannibals who lived in the north within the game. And then we've got the Hisilach, or the Izila, as you say, as everybody but me says. So the Izila, they live in the south, and they're not very nice. They think they're better than everybody, and basically your interaction with them is they're always capturing Wenja and Udam and enslaving them. And they use them to build these big, beautiful standing stones that they use to worship their gods. Now both Wenja and Azila are what we call conlangs. Have you guys ever heard of this term before, conlang? So that's short for constructed language. And this is contrasting with a natural language. A natural language is a language that comes about naturally. A constructed language is one that you create yourself for some particular reason. You've heard of a number of languages that are conlangs. Some of the first conlangs are languages that were designed to be international languages. So who here has heard of Esperanto? Okay, so Esperanto was designed about 150 years ago by a Polish doctor named Zamenhof. And he lived, I forget which city within Poland, but he lived within a city where there are different boroughs that spoke different languages. And he realized that if everyone spoke the same language, then people would get along a bit better. We have similar intentions with another doctor who's German this time, who invented a language called Volapük. And both of these languages were designed to be very simple, very straightforward, easy to learn, especially for the Europeans that these languages were created for. More famous, though, for conlangs are languages like this. So this is a very famous ring. Does anybody know what language that ring is inscribed in? Yeah, so Elvish. Yeah, so Elvish. There are actually multiple dialects of Elvish, and the guy who created Elvish, who was, of course, J.R.R. Tolkien, was in fact a linguist, and he first invented the languages and then wrote stories to, you know, to use the languages within. Or there's a very famous language these days for this particular TV series, Game of Thrones. Does anybody know what the language is called? Dothraki. Yeah.
Extremely uncomfortable chair.
Yeah, exactly. And then, of course, there are other languages, you know, like Klingon and for Star Trek and Na'vi for Avatar. There are a lot of constructed languages being invented today for all sorts of types of media. Now, those last four or five languages that I mentioned are all artistic conlangs. So they're conlangs that are invented for some form of art. And my conlangs are also artistic because they're invented for a video game, but there's a big difference between my conlangs and the ones that are invented for, say, Lord of the Rings or Game of Thrones. My conlangs are based in a significant amount of fact, right? So they are designed to be identical to, or at least very similar to, a language called Proto-Indo-European. Proto is basically a prefix that we use in linguistics. I'm a linguist, by the way. That's my normal job. I'm a linguistics professor. But we use this prefix proto to say that this language is very old and, most importantly, was never written down. So when we talk about Proto-Indo-European, this is a hypothetical language that we figure out by looking at languages like, well, for example, English and Spanish, Russian, Farsi, Greek, Hindi, French, Armenian, the list goes on and on. About half of the world today speaks an Indo-European language either natively or as a second language. Now, who were these guys, the Indo-Europeans or the Proto-Indo-Europeans? It's likely that they lived right here, so in the area of modern-day Ukraine. So you guys have heard a lot about Ukraine in the news, especially Crimea, which is right down there. It's likely that they lived in this particular region about 5,000 to 7,000 years ago, and they migrated far. You can see that they go all the way up to Scandinavia, all the way far west to France, all the way down here to India, up here to western China. They really went everywhere. There's a big reason for this. It's very likely that the Indo-Europeans were the first people to invent, to pioneer horseback riding. So this is actually something that wasn't done until about 5,000 to 7,000 years ago. We've actually, we being other scholars here, we've actually proved by looking at the graves within this particular region that the horses that were buried within these particular graves had significant signs of bit wear. And so it demonstrated that these guys actually had invented horseback riding. And that's why they're so successful. And that, by the way, is why half of the world today speaks an Indo-European language. It's because 7,000 years ago, these guys were extremely successful culturally and militarily. Here are all the main Indo-European branches. You can see up there, Germanic. English is a part of Germanic. Celtic here, so this is from about 2,500 years ago. Languages like Irish Gaelic and Gaulish, Indo-Aryan languages like Hindi, etc., etc. I don't want to bore you guys with the details because you're here for games, not for linguistics. Now, why on earth did I end up in this project, right? Fate, really. So, about 4 years ago, I went to a lecture by the archaeologist named David Anthony, who figured out that the Indo-Europeans had pioneer horseback riding. And I went out for beers with him, and at the end of the evening, I shook his hand, I said, David, if you ever need anything related to Indo-European linguistics, you just let me know. Well, about a year later, I got an email from Archaeology Magazine saying, hey, David Anthony recommended you for doing some recordings of Indo-European. We're wondering if you're interested in it. Yeah. So for about a day and a half, I practiced doing two Indo-European fables. At the time, this kid in the back, Alex, you want to wave hello? So Alex was about 6 months old, and as you guys know down there, when you read stories, you put on voices, right? So in the past, when people had recorded Indo-European, it was all like this, they were like droning on, doing mantras, like, and nobody really liked it. But when I did these fables, I did voices. So for example, let's see if there's a sample here. This is a sample from the King and the God. And in the King and the God, there's a king, there's a god, there's a priest, and everybody gets their own voice. So the king's like super whiny, and the god has this really booming voice, right? So here's a sample of actual Proto-Indo-European, what we think it sounded like. Rex has so los, rex suchnumunchto, tosio keltum rex, suchnus moi gunchetot. See how I shifted registers? I shifted voices, right? And for whatever reason, for that, or who knows, these things went crazy viral. So last I checked, the fables had like 1.5 million listens. That's ridiculous, right? As an academic, so my normal day job is I teach students linguistics, I write articles, and if I'm lucky, 100 people will read that article. And now I'm getting like 1.5 million listens. This is ridiculous. Now, what this ended up doing, though, is now when you Google Proto-Indo-European, guess who's at the top? Totally unjustified, right? There are so many Indo-Europeanists who should be up there. But I'm at the top. And so when Ubisoft was making a game and they wanted to use Proto-Indo-European, they just contacted the first person in a Google search, right? And it just so happened that I'm a huge gamer, and I was like, this is the job, this is the dream job, this is amazing, right? Now, to a lot of people, when you talk about figuring out an ancient language that was spoken 6,000-8,000 years ago, they're like, you're making stuff up. And that's technically true. We are making stuff up, but we're doing it in a very educated fashion. You can see exactly how we do this. Here we've got two words that are reconstructable for Proto-Indo-European. In each of these columns, you can see different Indo-European languages. Greek, Latin, Sanskrit, English, and Old Irish, which is the ancient source of Irish Gaelic. The first row here, we've got the word that means brother. The Greek word is pater. That means not a brother, but like a member of a secret society. And we get that sense of brother also in English. Frater in Latin, which you know through words like fraternal, fraternity, right? Sanskrit, bhatar. English, brother, and Old Irish, brathair. You see that these words actually look really similar. They all begin with a sound that's similar to a V. It's either a buh or a BH, buh, or a sound also made with the lips, a PH, puh, or another sound made with the lips, F. You can see that each of those sounds is followed by an R, followed by usually an A vowel, and then a T-like sound, and then a vowel, and then it ends in an R. And when you see these kinds of correspondences, you're like, all right, this isn't magic. This is just obvious. Obviously, these things are related in some sort of way, right? And the basic idea is that it's not that Greek borrowed the word from Sanskrit or Greek borrowed the word from Latin or whatever. It's that all of these words go back to some ancestral language that was never written down. Or the word for carry. Fair, bear. And you can see something that's also important, even more important just than just the correspondences that we're seeing. The correspondences themselves are regular, right? So whenever English has a V, Greek has a PH, Latin has an F, Sanskrit has a BH, right? And it's this way that this becomes a science. And this doesn't just become guesswork. And these are the two words that we reconstruct for Proto-Indo-European. Brachter and bear. Those are the two words, and in Wenja, this would be brashtar, so the title of the talk was Suwon Brashtar. And if you play the game, you hear the word brashtar all the time. That's the word brother, and brashtar is just derived from this right here. And in Zila, it would be brachter, it is basically identical to Indo-European. In Wenja, this would be bada, the word for carry, and in Zila, it would be bed. Okay, so they contacted me, but I learned later that they had done other trials to figure out exactly what language they were going to use for the video. So I learned later that initially they tried out the dialogue scenes in English, and they soon realized, because this was a game set about 12,000 years ago in the past, it just felt weird. It just felt odd. Why would they be speaking English? The English didn't even exist back then. Then they tried caveman English, which felt even more wrong. Taka, go get green beef, right? Something like that. And they're like, this sounds ridiculous. And whenever you do that voice, it's comical. It's not serious at all. And they really wanted a serious game. They really wanted people to feel like the guys in the game were human beings and that you could experience the things that they were trying to experience. And that's why they went for a language like Proto-Indo-European. Here's some numbers for you for the game. This project was huge. So, as we saw, there were three tribes, the Winja, the Udam, and the Hsilach. For those three tribes combined, about 2,400 unique words were created for the game, all of which, for the most part, were based on actual words within Proto-Indo-European. This was for a 40,000-word-long script. Now, this isn't for the dialogue that you see within the cinematics. And most of these words, as you guys know, being game developers, were for barks, right? So for those things that you hear out in the real world, right? So you're walking around, you run into another Wendigo tribesman, they're like, hey, right? Why'd you do that? Or what's up? Or something like that, right? So you have to translate those things. Now, each of these bits of script had to be translated, of course. They also had to be recorded for me, and they had to be sent through a localization team in order to, you know, be coded into the game correctly, because everybody who's doing this besides me and my team has no idea what this dialogue is actually saying. right? So they had to be very strict about how this was all put together. Now, because this project was so big, I soon realized that I needed help. So usually when I do this talk, my wife's with me. She's at home with our new baby who's 2 weeks old, so she couldn't be here right now. She was the one who was in charge of teaching the language. We'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But I got three friends of mine from grad school to help me figure out how exactly we translate what we know Proto-Indo-European to have been to a setting that was appropriate for a video game, and to also do a lot of the translation work itself. A lot of these things were really contentious. So do you remember when I was speaking Proto-Indo-European and had all the So when Ubisoft heard this, they were like, no. There's no actor that can do this. This is going to be too hard. They can't learn it. And you got to put yourself in the actor's shoes. Now, it's not totally unreasonable for Ubisoft to think this, because the actors not only had to memorize a completely made-up language, they also had to act, right? And they had to learn new movements. So every tribe learned to move in a particular way. So the Udom were very plodding, kind of more like the cavemen that you think about. And the Azila kind of floated through the world. And all of these things had to be captured by the actors. So Ubisoft, when they heard all those chuz, they're like, get rid of all the chuz. And I told them, I said, guys, if we get rid of all the chuz, it's no longer Proto-Indo-European. That's like saying, okay, I want American English, but no American R. That's ridiculous, right? One of the main features of American English is in fact, if you ask foreigners, like, what does American English sound like, they usually make fun of the R, right? So you can't take away the chuz. So I came up with a formula for them. I said, okay, I will get rid of 90% of the chuz, but we have to keep 10% of them. They're like, okay. So we had to make these kinds of compromises. Now, the two languages themselves are based on Proto-European. But if you're playing the game, you probably don't know that they're related in any sort of way, because they sound very different. And that was done so intentionally. We wanted Azila to be as close to Proto-Indo-European as possible. Now, when I initially pitched Proto-Indo-European for the game, it originally was designed to be Wenja. And I had two other things that I was going to do for Azila and Udo. But when they heard Proto-Indo-European, they're like, no, that sounds too modern. It sounds too much like Greek or Latin. Well, there's a reason for that, you know. Latin and Greek come from Proto-Indo-European. So they said, what we want you to do is we want you to use Proto-Indo-European and use it for the Azila. So we wanted to make Azila as true to Proto-Indo-European as possible. However, there was one problem we were continually running into. Our words were too long, especially for the barks. So to give you an example, one of the words we had to make up for the game was the word for yak. There is no word for yak that's reconstructable that we can know for Proto-Indo-European. So if you're tasked with figuring out a word for yak, what would you do? What would you call a yak?
Yes.
Yeah. You describe the animal visually.
Yeah.
Like that.
So what would you say?
Large hairy cow monster.
All right, so that's definitely too long. But what I did was I took two of those words that you just said and did precisely that. I said shaggy cow. The word for shaggy is the source of our word dense. Dunsu in Proto-European becomes densus, or densus within Latin. The word for cow, our word cow, goes back to gross, which within Wenja would have been gawi. So dansu gawi was the word for yak. And so they heard that. They're like, look, the word is dansu gawi. The only time you're going to be hearing yak is if someone's yelling at you, yak! Because a yak is charging at you, right? And you wouldn't know what it is by syllable three because you would have gotten run over. So I was like, okay. All right, so Dansu Gawi, let's cut it down to two syllables. And so it becomes Dungao. It's still too long. We want it to be the same number of syllables as in English. And so that's why when you hear the word for yak in the game, it becomes Dung. So Dansugawi to Dangal to Dong. So we had to make a lot of accommodations, both in Azila and in Wenja. We also eliminated a lot of the grammar. If anybody in here has studied Latin or Greek, awesome. So you know in Latin, one of the hardest things about Latin is the grammar. There's a lot of grammar. We got rid of a lot of that when it was simply a not necessary. There are dozens of tenses that we can reconstruct for Proto-Indo-European. Within the game, within Azila, we have two, because that's all you need. We also wanted the language to be as phonologically distinct, that is, distinct in sound, from Wendigo as possible. But we didn't want it to be too hard for the actors, as I mentioned earlier, because they had to act. How about Wendigo and Udom? Earlier I said that Azila to, that is, actual Proto-Indo-European to the developers, sounded too modern. I said, okay, you want me to make this older? I'll make this older. We have techniques within linguistics. I won't bore you with the details. We have techniques in linguistics to kind of roll back, turn back the clock. Right? So what I did was I designed Wendigo to be proto-Indo-European. How do I do this? Well, if you look at any language, you can see that there are strange patterns. Patterns that don't make any sense within the language at that point in time. And the only reason they exist is for historical reasons. Think of things like in English, the verb to be. I be, you be, he, she, it, bees. No. I am, you are, he, she, it, is. I was, they were, I have been, to be. What is all that stuff, right? There's a reason for that. It's due to Proto-Indo-European, right? We just held on to those words because they're really common. Or if you look at grammar, usually when we make past tenses within English, to kick, I have kicked. To kiss, I have kissed. To hug, I have hugged, right? But then we have verbs like sing, sang, sung, ring, rang, groan, and that's actually something that we can reconstruct all the way back to Proto-Indo-European, and we see this with the verb to cover. Tego in Latin is I covered, and a covering is toga. The thing to focus on is how it's gone from an E vowel to an O vowel, right? This is a vowel alternation that we can trace all the way back to Proto-Indo-European. So what we did was we were like, okay, what are some funny things that we can reconstruct for Proto-Indo-European that perhaps could go back to something even older? You guys know the expression quid pro quo? So quid pro quo means literally what for what. Note that both words for what begin with the qua sound. And note that almost all of our words that are question words in English begin with a WH sound. Who, why, where, whither, whence, things like that, right? All WH sounds. And these things go back to a qua sound. So what I thought is, if all of the words for questions have some sort of qua or ku within it, why don't we just use the word ku to mark questions? So to say, I speak Wendigo, you say, Wendigo wadam. And if you ask, do I speak Wendigo? You say, ku Wendigo wadam. Right? And so we took an old pattern, what looks really archaic, and we made it kind of a baseline feature of the language. And that's how we made Proto-Indo-European or Wendigo. Okay, so this is what the languages sound like. Remember this text from Proto-Indo-European. Rex heso, budos, rex suchnum, dunto, tosio geltum, rex suchnus, moi gunkitod. Okay? This is how it sounds in Azila. Rex heso, budos, rex suchnum, welhet. You'll note that a lot of the ch sounds have been taken out, right? That was the whole, I get rid of 90% from Ubisoft, right? The intonation pattern, the sing-songiness, has been even more exaggerated, right? This is to make it sound even more different from Wendigo. What does Wendigo sound like? This is the same fable from Proto-Indo-European. Sams fragi, sam putila, fragi sushnu walha. Sounds very different, but if you look at the actual words, they're the same, right? So, putila, putlos, fragi, rex, sushnu, suchnum, right? They're actually the same things, but just have different rules to produce these particular words. And if you're playing in the game, playing in the world, you hear all sorts of words, especially words that deal with animals, right? Because in the game, you are the beastmaster. You are the Guadapati. And you hear words like biqua, which means bee. And you'll note that the bee in biqua is our word bee. Or you'll hear faran. So those in Far Cry, there are always these annoying eagles, right, that attack you. And that is related to all sorts of things like the fancy word ornithology, the study of birds, the ornin. Is related to the pharaoh within the game. Or the word for bear, hadas. Hadas is related to all sorts of things like Latin ursus, ursine, the word Arctic, as in the Arctic Circle is where the bears live. It's related to all sorts of things. Even King Arthur is King Bear Guy, something like that. Or the word for lion, Lauhan. See, it's not a huge stretch to go from Lauhan to lion, because it, in fact, is related to it. All right. So that's how we made the languages, and that's how we translated it, but that was only half of the job. Because we, after making all this stuff, we had to go to Canada, we had to go to Toronto, and we had to train some people in the actual languages. We spent about 3 months in Toronto training people in the languages. And you can see here that all of the scenes for the cinematics, and I imagine this won't be surprising to you guys, were done using mocap. So they're all dressed up in black suits with balls and all that stuff. And we had to go to Toronto to train them how to do that. Here's a picture of me doing recordings in Toronto. Hmm. And here's a picture of my wife teaching Wenja. Now, my wife, Brenna, Brina, wants to be here. Can't. She decided that when she got to Toronto, people were really freaked out about this job. That is the actors. They're like, oh my God, how am I going to do this? This is too hard. So she knew as a professor, as a language professor, the best way to get them comfortable in doing it was to teach them lessons in Wenja, fully immersed. Right? And we'll see just a taste of this in just a couple of minutes. Here, she's training the actors. Here's Ul, here's Da, here's Karush, if you guys remember those characters. And what she would do with each lesson is she would begin by talking or by showing them some basic words in Wenja. So the word for hard, saiwa. Saiwa. The word for rock, shash.
Shash.
Hard like rock, saiwa shashwai.
Saiwa shashwai.
To build is damsha.
Damsha.
A hut is damshi.
Damshi.
We build is damshmas.
Damshmas.
We keep building huts. It's dumshi dum dumshmas.
Dumshi dum
dumshmas. Now, I want to point something out because I can't resist. You see this dom here? This is in Proto-Indo-European, dom. And this is the same root as in domesticated, domicile, and things like that. It meant to build or it meant a house. So, what she would do is she would say, okay, guys, we're going to start with a little Wenja conversation. And what I want you to understand is nu haiwa Wenja. And so for a full hour, she would only speak Wenja. So, Wenja San English. She would begin by what I began with, Smarkaka. And everybody would say, Smarkaka, Smarkaka. Mu Brina, or Mu Andrew. Mu Brina, Mu Andrew. Mi Nashman, Andrew. Ti. Hi, Nashma.
Christina.
Ta Christina.
Ta Christina.
Mu Christina.
Mu Christina.
Mi Nashman Christina. Okay, so what does mu mean?
Me.
Maybe I am, maybe me, maybe I, right? Just so happens you don't have a verb to be in Wenja unless you're like proclaiming. So like in the game, at the very beginning, Takar says, Takar Hasam. Hassam is like, I am Taka. Normally it would be like, Mu Taka. Right? Mi Nashman, what do you think that means?
My name.
Yeah. And Nashman is, unsurprisingly, our word name, right? Just with some Indo-European stuff. Mi literally means to me. But Mi Nashman is how you say my name.
So that's me, not me.
Huh?
So that's me, not me.
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 Me. Yeah, but usually in the game it gets shortened to just me. Nashman, me, Nashman. You see, they're very, very similar. You can also see that by doing that, I did not explicitly tell you, everyone, the word for I or me or I am is mu. There is no copulate. There is no verb to be. I didn't do that, right? That's boring. You're already asleep, right? What Brenna did was she taught the language in context, and immediately it was just like just black and white, night and day, how much more comfortable people were with the languages after.
Were they having like conversations and stuff like that?
Kind of. I mean, they would say hello and they would cuss and things like that. We'll hear some cuss words in a few minutes. I will spell them out. Alright, here's a scene being filmed. This is actually the actor who does Erky, who we'll see in just a few minutes. The distant ancestor of Herc. Have you guys played Far Cry? Herc is this kind of southern stereotype of a character.
Oh, yeah.
He has these weird things with monkeys.
Yeah.
I think he's completely bizarre.
Awesome.
But you can see him, he's in a suit and you've got the microphones over him. And of course, these studios are just amazing. They've got like 200 cameras, you know, filming them so that they can translate them into computer animation. All right, so let's watch a couple scenes here. All right, the first scene. The first scene is with Teensai. And Teensai is the shaman within the game. There are loads of scenes with him. He knows that that is Takar. He knows that you're coming. He knows that you're going to save the tribe. And he's so excited when he meets you because he knows what's going to happen. He's also the person who gives you this magical power to command beasts and be the beast master. I'm sorry. So that's Teensai. All in all, there are about eight or so characters who speak in Wenja. Now, one of the cool things about the game is that we made sure that each character had their own unique voice, but that it also made sense as a coherent tribe. But this language, though, is different. So this is a completely different language. This is the Azila that I was talking about. And this is your first meeting. The first meeting with Batari, so the queen of New Zealand. How do I turn it up?
Oh, no.
You
computer people, help me!
Hit F12.
Huh?
Hit F12. There you go.
Okay.
Scroll down a little bit.
This is so awkward.
Not the comments, oh my gosh.
What an awful, awful part of the internet.
Okay, you see that speaker icon at the bottom?
There we go.
Yeah.
You can hit the up arrow.
Hover over the speaker icon. Like,
next to where
you
click play.
On the your right.
There you go.
Yeah. Drag it.
Okay. Beautiful sounds. One of the cool things about this scene is, so the grammar of Izila was meant to reflect the kind of the haughty nature of their culture. So in Proto-European, there were three genders, masculine, feminine, and neuter, just like in German and Latin. But we decided to make two genders, rational and irrational. So the rational group were the Izila, the gods, and any Wenja that they respect. And so when Batari starts addressing Takar in the scene, she starts addressing him as a rational human being. So she says, Belos Hesi, which means you are the Hesi, a strong Belos, a strong man, a strong person. But if she, later in the scene, when he says, Nakwai Bidam, which means I serve no one, she gets mad. And she's like, okay, you're a Tolid, you're an it. So she switches that like that. Alright, this final scene, just for fun, is scene with Erki. Now Erki, as I mentioned earlier, he was the guy in the picture, he was the one doing the mocap. He is the same actor, his name is Dylan Taylor, I believe, who does Herc in all of the Far Cry games. Now, Herc is this really weird, bizarre character. He somehow ends up in the Himalayas for Far Cry 4, somehow ends up in the jungle in Far Cry 3. He has this obsession with monkeys and tattoos. Now, the funny thing about Herc and translating Herc for Far Cry Primal is that most of what you hear in the game, I'd say about 95%, is Dylan just completely improvising. He basically knows, he's like, okay, I'm supposed to tell the main character that he needs to go over there, right? And he's got dialogue for like 20 seconds. And then it becomes like a 4-minute scene with him making up things about tattoos and monkeys. But how do you have improv with a made-up language, right? So here's what we did. We had the basic script. And we knew that in every quest that you did with her, he always ends up almost dying at the end. And the words that he uses within these scenes, I think he usually has about 15 to 20 words within each dialogue. And so Dylan and I would sit down and say, all right, Dylan, how would Herc say this sentence? And instead of saying something like, I'm going to fly, he says something like, I'm going to fly like a GD flying saber-toothed tiger. How do I say that? So we translate that. And then we do the same. So we actually had a list of about 30 words that are not translated properly within the game. They're all translated as like darn and little critter and things like that. But there's some filthy words in the scenes. There's about a list of 30 words that we came up with. We call them Herkisms. And all of the creative dev team, everybody working on the game, would say things like Kaz Damascus, which is actually really filthy, and things like that. I don't know why it's not coming up.
Okay. Yeah, for space.
Urky. Ash, Urky, Udam, Ash. Urky, Udam, Mumble. Udam, Urky, Garza. Mounta! Mounta!
That means damn it. You can see that he doesn't sound like the other people, right? And this was a decision that was really controversial. So some of the writers were like, I don't know. You know, what are we doing here? But I had, this is actually my fault. So I had actually asked Dylan to read the script as Herc would read it. And I thought it was so funny. He sounded like my Uncle Marty. I was like, we have to do this. And everybody was laughing, and so that convinced the team. But what I really wanted to make sure that every substitution he was making, like, so for example, he said, not salvaita, that means you save. He said, salvada, actually, salvada, right? And so, you know, in Southern English, we still do the ho sounds, like, which, right? And most Americans would say, which. That is, which, sorcerer, which, right? Every time he did a W, I said, Dylan, you gotta do a what? It's gotta be regular, it's gotta make sense as a linguistic system. So it was coherent. And when people come up to me, they're like, why is he speaking like a Southern, you know, Southern American? People didn't speak like that back then. I said, you have no idea how people talk. 10,000 years ago. This could be the right way. And the other way is wrong. We don't know this. Plus, they're my languages. Shut up. Okay. So, that is all I have for you guys. If you're interested in these things, the work that I did, I actually, off and on over the last year or so, have worked on a blog, speakingprimal.blogspot.com. I'm on Twitter, @speakingprimal. These days, most of my tweets are political. But every once in a while, there's something that deals with language. I actually have had the pleasure of having another project. This wasn't on a video game, but there's a National Geographic show called Origins, and I translated 8 languages for them. 6 proto-languages and 2 actual real languages. That was really cool. I talk about these sorts of things on the blog. Thank you very much.